Yes.
We're good.
Please stand for the oath. Turn off your cell phones. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for attending our October board meeting. We'll start with our introductions. We've got Eric Czar, Assistant General Manager. I'm Jerry Mupo, your General Manager. We've got Lynn Tavernetti, Board President. Jeannie Glanville, our Board Vice President. Fred Weck, Board Secretary. Jerry Monahan, Board Director. Claudine Diaz, CFO. We also have Cindy Graves, our Activities Director, and Tad Creasy, our Regional Manager from First Service. Okay, just a few announcements. We have been advised that our Recreation Center 3 is due to start construction on November 1. So we're very excited to hear that. The conceptual plan we did post at the sign-in table, so you can take a look and remind yourself what we can expect in the near future. Also, we've got a couple of rule amendments that are out waiting for your response. That would include the standing committee term limits, ballroom and social dance club guest policy, and trail use. So make sure you do return those in. We're looking at a deadline of November 2nd so we can have all the responses prepared for board review at the November 10th board meeting. Also, we're getting a good return on our age verification forms. Just a reminder, if you have not turned that in, please do so. I'm hoping for 100% participation without my encouragement. And then also, just a reminder, we have been experiencing an exceptional amount of trash being left in the movie theater, and that includes people leaving their cups, leftover popcorn bags, tucking them into the seats. Just a reminder, we did put a trash can in the movie theater as well as outside by the popcorn machine. If you could please assist us in keeping the theater clean, we would really appreciate it. And do not pull on the facility doors after hours. I'm not sure if anybody knows that as you're walking around the building before the lodge opens, if you pull hard enough on the doors, it sets off the security alarms. Eric and I are continuing to get after-hour phone calls from our security team and the police department. And as a reminder, the police department will only respond to so many alarms for free. And after that limit has exceeded, we will start being charged for the extra service calls. So we appreciate the help in making sure that we're all secure here, but we've got it. Thank you. And then, organization chart. The board has asked the management company to prepare an organization chart as far as the positions here for the management staff and the direction of response and I'm having one of those moments. It also will include the top five responsibilities for each of our staff members. So that will be posted on the website within the next few days or so. Other than that, I think we're good. All right. Next on our agenda is homeowner input. And just a reminder, our game rules are that it is limited to 3 minutes per homeowner, and only one request to speak form may be submitted per homeowner. There'll be no sharing or passing of time to another person. Homeowner input may be held for a maximum period of 30 minutes before the board meeting begins to allow the board to proceed with the business portion of the meeting. This portion of the meeting is limited to board participation only. Residents are welcome and encouraged to stay for the full meeting to witness the business of the corporation taking place by your governing agents. So our first request to speak is Mike Saperstein.
I'm Mike Saperstein, as she said.
Which come on up to the podium.
Oh, podium. I'm not used to that. I've seen other people pull this down. There's
this speak?
Yes.
People can hear?
Okay.
I gotta look at my notes. Okay, I'm Mike Saperstein, and I am the bocce ball club president, and I spent about 11 months, month by month by month, presenting what other courts and other communities were, what ours were not quite finished as they ought to be to play on a smooth surface, to walk on a safe surface, to get to the court. Somehow K-Hog kind of stopped partway through. And so I spent, like say, 10 or 11 months facilities committee and getting things, bidding and so forth was taken care of by staff. And just recently they were submitted from the facilities committee to the finance committee and passed at approximately 31,500. That's the figures come up there. I'm just talking. But what we have on the existing courts that we've been playing on, and there's been consistently in nice weather, monthly usage of individuals walking out to play, there's been between 250, 260, 280 players per month using the courts. I think if you, they don't count down here, but up at the summit, they keep track of us when we come in. So they're heavily used and very, very good. They do have, when K-Hog built them, it's like a good foundation under a house with a poor top. Like all the lumber's correctly, or excuse me, all the bad on top. And so when we, the bid came out, we investigated once to dig up and start all over in a new area up there at the summit, that was $60,000 to $80,000 alleged applied. So the ones we have to redo the top with good concrete around, concrete under, turf, new paint, basically a safe condition that'll last a long, long time, and is at the newer, better price being presented today. And I know several people on the board have been at our bocce ball courts. I've seen them, and somebody has been at the committee meeting and listened to what we've been presenting. Well, there's always a board member at a committee. And the future maintenance is nothing more than concrete sidewalks out here. It's nothing like tennis courts that need new netting, new screens on the side, or a washdown. Just nice, bunch of people can go play for a long time to come, and that's, I'll be here for any questions from the board. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. Our next speaker is Donna Lewis.
Donna Lewis, 1554 Bighorn, and I'm also here in support of the bocce ball courts. We do play up there every week, and Mike has really done a tremendous job getting this through. There's a lot of DG up there. We're tracking down the courts. You know, it's everything that is being presented to the board, those bocce ball courts are going to be good for a long time. It's going to be safe for our players that are in wheelchairs. And the roll of the ball gets worse and worse every week, so it really is another great sport for here at Four Seasons. I truly believe that. And I'd also like to speak a little bit on the landscaping in D3. I think that was recently turned over to the HOA, and the hillside's there. I think the finance kicked it back to have the builder look at that again, because the slope between Glacier Park and Bighorn isn't very attractive. So I think we have a very small window here this time of year in between spring to get it approved for some sort of enhancement in that area. I think it was presented once that it all get killed off and replanted for amount of money that I thought was outrageous. So I just like to see it maybe make sure the irrigation is proper and make sure that the plants that we are putting up there, you know, are viable and that they'll survive. And I did notice they've done a really good job putting some really quality plants and quality size down in D3 and D45 going down, but it seems like right there in D3 is just a weird spot. And so I really like support from the board and the builder on having that common area look as nice as the rest of the community.
Our next speaker is Pete Percy.
I want to see the clock.
Technical difficulties.
My name is Pete Hersey. I'm at 154 Kettle Creek, and I'm representing the radio club. I'm the president of the radio club that supports emergency communications here at the in the community. One of our projects over the years has been to identify a means of backup power in the case we have an earthquake and lose electricity. This will be a big issue if we lose the grid. We've gone through gasoline generators. The board didn't like that. We then moved to propane type generators. The board didn't like that because we had to store 400 gallons of propane. Understandable. But then we settled on a battery backup concept with solar panel charging. Very benign type of situation. We have submitted a proposal to the board about a month ago detailing what we're asking for. And one of the things we wanted to do was have a storage cabinet, a locked storage cabinet, inside the existing radio room, which is in the rec center north. I think it's called Activity Room 4. And we were going to store the batteries, which are relatively small. They're not as big as a car battery, but they're quite powerful. Unfortunately, they are very high-tech batteries. They're very expensive. They cost $369 each. That's how expensive they are. I think it's pretty high. But we were assured by the manufacturer that these are safe. Well, in light of everything that's going on recently with Samsung and other people, these, by the way, are lithium-ion batteries. There's no getting around that. They are lithium-ion. There is a little bit different technology in that. They are much less prone to bursting into flame. However, they are not absolutely 100% guaranteed never to burst into flame. Based on that, an hour ago I pulled or asked the proposal that we submitted to be put off pending further evaluation. And we have some alternate ideas that will guarantee the safety of the community and from any fire hazard. So there are other ways we can go. Not quite as nice as what we had originally proposed, but we can live with it and it'll be much safer for the HOA. That's all I want to say. That's the reason that I pulled the proposal.
Thank you, Pete. Okay, our next speaker is Bob Melville.
I'm Bob Melville, 287 Chimney Drive. I'm also on the Finance Committee. I'm here to speak a few facts about the term limits proposal. And I know that's going to be addressed on the 2nd of November, but I want to put out some information before that from the other side. There's currently 10 standing committees made up of 71 members. There are 13 vacant positions. In other words, 18% of the 71 are currently available. There are approximately 30 committee members out of the 58 existing members that would be termed out based on a 4-year service time. That's pretty high to have that kind of turnover. There is only one member on more than one committee, and that person was put on a second committee based on a board appointment. In other words, they're not knocking the doors down to get on these committees. Anyway, that means that there would be 43 out of the 71 positions open based on the 4-year term limit. In other words, 61% of the existing members that have been there for 4 years or more would be open. That's quite a turnover out of 71. Many of these people are on very, very important committees that require a lot of background and expertise in specific areas. Much of that would be lost based on this term limit proposal. Where are all the people knocking on the doors to get on these committees? I've been on a committee for 9 years, and we've always had turnover. Currently on the Finance Committee, we've had two in the last year and a half. That's 28, almost 29% turnover in less than the last 2 years. That's pretty hefty, and it's probably about as much as you could stand and still maintain the quality and the qualification level that's required. All I'm saying is that on the 2nd of November, that both sides be given the opportunity to make a presentation. It shouldn't be dominated by that domination, I mean media domination, by one side. I know we had an open forum, but it was there to propose a one-sided viewpoint. The one on the 2nd of November should not be that. And secondly, it's too important to have it based on comment input. If you want to go hell-bent for it, then make it a vote by all membership, and they have to require 51% of the members to support it, not comments. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Bob. Our next speaker is John McLaughlin.
Thank you. I'm going to speak on term limits also, and I want to state the fact I'm not necessarily against term limits, but I have some concerns with the way it's currently being presented to us. I think the recruitment during the holidays is a very bad time. Committees often do not meet in December, and it's going to make it hard to process any new members that might come out of this. I don't know why we can't stay with our normal rotation in May and work it from there. I would also like to see us wait until the November 3rd meeting and see if there's much turnout, if there's much interest for the 13 vacancies, and if there isn't, maybe we need to reconsider term limits or give more study to it. The one-time extension isn't real clear to me. Is it for any number who are termed out but there's no replacement for? Is it just for one? You know, we need more research on that. The existing rules for the committees allow the board to make an emergency appointment if a committee drops below a quorum, so I see no reason to give the liaison voting privilege for the same reason. We already have a method to handle that. If the members can only be added to the committees in January, if that's the way I interpret it, then if you have someone leave in March, you have to wait till next January to get a new member. You can't appoint all through the year. So that seems to be a little hazy. Who's going to track all this? Who's going to, for the removal and the termed out? And then why hasn't this followed the normal procedure of going to the Rules and Regulations Committee for vetting? All our rules previous, the rules and regulations have been in existence since 2006. So for 10 years, we've done it where they get the rules and then they give it back to the board for their input and approval or change. But for some reason, this rule seems to bypass that system. So I think you need to rethink that too and let rules and regulations do their job. It seems to me the need for term limits so far is just a perception. There's no real hard facts to determine this. And I think that it's only to appease a special interest group that wanted term limits rather than having a focused study, factual study of the need for term limits and how they would fit into our current rules. An example is EPC committee, Emergency Preparedness. We were formed in 2013. We only have two members left that were from that original group. We have two vacancies. So, I mean, it hasn't been like people are sitting in there forever. We will have those two members termed out with the passage of this rule. So my opinion is that it needs more study. It's just not ready yet, and you need to give it more time, more looking at. And also, if this change is made, why don't we also include term limits for the board? That was part of the election previous to this, a hot topic. So, got to include that also. Thank you.
Okay, I have no further request to speak forms, so we'll continue on with our agenda. The next item on our agenda is the consent calendar. The purpose of the consent calendar is to make a single motion to approve all included items. If for a particular reason an item needs to be discussed or pulled from the consent calendar, then a call to remove that item should be made by a board member. Currently on the consent calendar, we have the minutes from the September 8th, 2016 meeting and the September 29th, 2016 special meeting. Approval of the 2016 August financial statements, CD investment plan, and there are no analysis requests or liens or foreclosure actions.
We have a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the consent calendar.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the consent calendar. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Next item on our agenda is the report on executive session or action taken between meetings. There was an executive session held this morning at 9 a.m. There were 7 delinquency hearings held, 5 of which paid prior to the hearing. There were 5 enforcement hearings and 3 requests to speak to the board. Contracts renewed was Coast Fitness and the LeBar Oxney HOA General Liability Insurance policy. There were 2 legal issues reviewed and no personnel issues. So we'll go ahead and move into our committee reports. First up is architectural.
Good afternoon, everybody. Jerry, you whipped through those so fast, I wasn't ready for my turn yet. Okay, so I'm Tom Halley. I'm chair of the Architectural Review Committee. The homeowners kept us very busy in September, as every month. We had 16 guests come to either observe our committee or have submissions. With that, we had 13 new applications and 12 were approved. We had 29 addendums or amendments to current work being done or additions to the work being done, of which we approved 26. And the Exhibit C's, which is the notice of completion, we received 29 of those and 28 of those were completed. In the November Breeze article, we're going to touch on the rules surrounding holiday decorations with the season coming up, as well as timelines. And we also had 2 extension requests for homeowners that were unable to complete the work during their allotted time period, and one of those was approved. Just a couple of things for homeowners. Architecture guidelines came out, I don't know, 4 or 6 weeks ago. Most recently, you received with additional mailers the new exhibits. And I just wanted to run through those. Exhibit A is the initial submission or application for any work to be done. The Exhibit B is the neighbor notification, and the Exhibit C is the notice of completion when the work is done. When you submit additional, or from here on out, when you submit, please use the new Exhibits A, B, and C because they have changed from the ones that you had originally. Exhibits D through K, if you are going to have extensive work done, please take a look at those. They're reference exhibits to help homeowners understand what is being required or what is necessary for your submission. I would like to point out Exhibit B, the neighbor notification. We've noticed that homeowners are not being really great about getting the neighbor's signatures on those. Just so everyone's aware, if your neighbor comes to you or you need to go to your neighbor for the Exhibit B, you are not signing off that you approve for the work being done. You are signing off that you acknowledge they are going to have this work done. And it's really more of a courtesy to all of the neighbors as you have workmen coming and noise going on and all that. So it's just so they know that this work is going to be done on your property. So with that, our meetings are the first and third Wednesday of each month at 8:30 in the RCN conference room. And our next meeting is on the 19th, and the one following that is on the 2nd. So again, we encourage homeowners to join us, see what our committee is about, see if you might like to join the architectural committee, and also if you do have any kind of submission, it's very helpful to us and to you if you could attend our meetings. So, any questions from the board?
Thank you.
Okay, our next committee is the Bistro Committee.
Good afternoon. I'm Ann Blair, I'm the co-chair of the Bistro Committee, and our meeting are on the last, or the fourth Wednesday of every month. It'll be the 26th next month, and we invite anyone to come and observe our meeting. We did have a resignation of Suzanne Roldan on last meeting. We accepted her resignation. And we also were able to induct two new members, Sherry Howard and Bob Brandon. And we have a proposal for two new members to be approved today, which we hope will be approved. We are submitting two proposals to the Finance Committee for expansion and remodeling of the kitchen. Right now, the kitchen is, they're using basically the same kind of appliances that we use in our homes. The fryer is about this big, and it's really causing a problem, especially on Friday nights when the kitchen gets backed up. So we're proposing to remodel the kitchen. The appliances are all 10 years old, so it's time to replace them anyway. So it's a good time to remodel the kitchen, make it more efficient so that they can have more cooks. They can use two cash registers and get people through, you know, better service the community as it's growing. So we're submitting two proposals to the Finance Committee. The basic difference in those proposals is the equipment itself, the quality or whatever of the appliances. So we've only been able to locate one company that will come in and handle it from soup to nuts. They'll manage the construction, they'll manage all the subcontractors, and they'll do everything for us. And Smitty really likes them. So we're submitting the two proposals from this one company, and we hope that the board and the Finance Committee will consider that in light that we spent a couple of months looking for somebody else to come in and haven't been able to find them. So the other thing is that we're in the process of changing the Bistro Committee to be called something like the Lodge Committee. We're trying to think of a better name than that, but we would interface with all those people up there. A whole lot of things. The ad hoc committee, the ballroom, the billiards room, the card room, the gym, the salon. So we're looking to see what needs to be done to interface with those people. And we're also looking to expand the Bistro Committee so that we can have subcommittees to better service that. Any questions? Thank you.
Is there a motion to approve Sherry Howard and Bob Brandon to be appointed to the committee?
A motion, then.
I'll second. I have a question. What are their jobs going to be?
That's a good question. I'm not really sure exactly what it entails to interface with these other things.
Okay.
I think that we'll have to kind of feel our way through that.
Would you come back to the next meeting and tell us what their jobs are?
Okay. I mean, I think, you know, what I foresee, you know, think that it will be like if there's a, you know, the, like we said about the cleaning up of the movie theater, you know, just things like that. When issues come up, they'll be handled.
Just come back and tell us what their jobs are.
Okay.
Okay.
I think it's
been moved and seconded to accept these two new members onto our committee.
Actually, those members have already been approved. It's two additional members.
Understand. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes.
Okay, so on page 33 of the packet is the proposed Bistro Committee Charter. I think we're going to put table that until further discussion on the committee. On page 34 is a proposed change for the new homeowner meet and greets as submitted by the Bistro Committee. Did the board have any comments or questions regarding the recommendations?
Oh, I'm sorry?
When do you propose to have the first meeting?
Well, that hasn't been decided yet. They're usually held quarterly.
Did the board have any questions, or are they, do they accept this proposed change to the homeowner fee agreement?
It says here, no groups may set up any displays except for proposals. So in terms of recruiting the committees, recruiting the neighborhood watch, or anything like that, that did not happen.
That's the way I read it. So the comment was that the setup for recruiting for committees would be done in the lobby rather than the ballroom.
We have a room in the lobby. The reasoning, if I could speak, the reasoning for that is because it's too distracting to have other things going on while we're presenting to the new homeowners. So if it's done held outside, they can talk about, you know, talk to the various committees and so forth, and then come in and be, you know, present at the presentations.
Is the intent of this only at that point in time when you're having the meet and greet that they have their set up in the lobby?
Yeah.
Not just other times? Maybe it should specify that specifically during meet and greet for clarification.
Okay.
So any other times other than during your meet and greets, clubs?
During the meet and greets, they
would
not
any other time they can be in the boat?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. Just during the meet and greets to avoid you know, confusion.
Thank you.
Yeah, Colleen, I think it's clarified when you read that it's proposed changes for the meet and greet specifically.
I'm sorry, what?
So I think it's clarified your concern about having it be for other things, because this is specific to meet and greets.
I understand that, but a lot of people interpret things when they read them a little differently. Just clarification.
I think the system is very similar to what we're currently doing. The only addition would be that there would be presentations given by our committees, the committee chairs, during the meet and greet. I think that's the only addition.
I think one of the other additions is that we recognize committees as, you know, for providing the food and you know, refreshments at the committee and introduce him so that they're all familiar with him.
Okay.
We have a proposal to accept.
Make a motion we accept it as presented.
I'll second. It's
been proposed and seconded that we accept the proposed changes for the new homeowner meet and greet. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Okay, next committee is our communication committee.
Folks, there's been a lot of recruitment for committee membership. We're the coolest committee. Remember that. We've got a few things just to go over, and it'll be really quick. The breeze is working fine, the product's at a high level, and we hope it stays that way. Two, we felt that the proposed term limits were going to have a big effect on the communication committee. And so we talked about it officially as a committee and what we felt the problems were. And so we strongly object to the manner in which the term limits are being implemented. We find it to be, you know, find it will impose unneeded and damaging haste, or been imposed an unneeded and damaging haste. The present year-long terms of members has been reduced by 5 months, from May to January, leaving insufficient time for prudent change. There is no plan for orderly replacement of termed out members or to make sure there are sufficient replacements beyond a minimum quorum to ensure the committees have enough manpower to do their work. At least two of the committees, and probably more, will be decimated. Communications will lose 4 members and rules and regs will be reduced to 1 or 2 members, depending on whether the members on 2 committees elect to stay. These committees will be ineffective for some period of time. And we say that because it is going to affect the product that we produce, the breeze. Because the majority of the current committee's time is more editorial than anything in producing the magazine itself. And going on, we understand, Board Member Fred Wick, that there are already 13 vacancies on committees. We would suggest that these vacancies be filled before a wholesale purge of existing members begins. There is no provision for ensuring that residents with special skills are not arbitrarily removed only to have no similar qualified replacement available. And we find that with the people that are coming from the finance side or the people that are coming from the editorial side. These are unique skill sets that it's just hard to get qualified people to do. And maybe there's an alternative to make sure the jobs keep getting done professionally. We suggest that the current terms be allowed to run their original length until May to allow time for an orderly transition. During that time, the board should begin a recruiting program and find qualified replacements with advice from current committee members and let the outgoing members train them if possible. No committee should lose more than two members at a time. The interval between expulsions would be determined by the board, but in no case should it be less than 6 months. Extension allowances should be for at least 6 months to allow reasonable planning and continuity. The current vacancies should be filled, or nearly so, before expulsions begin. No specially qualified member should be expelled until a similarly qualified replacement is found. And I think your mentioning of the job descriptions is apropos in that area. If you know what the job descriptions are for the members, then you have a better idea of what you have to fill that position. We feel these steps would accomplish the goal of opening committee positions to newcomers, yet reduce the disruption of haste and mass expulsions. When the issue of term limits was first raised, the communication committee was divided. Some members were for them, some opposed, and some didn't care either way. There was sympathy for those wanting to participate, yet concerned about tinkering with a system that has served the wider community well. Now, however, the committee is unanimous in opposing the overly disruptive and overly hurried plan the board has presented. That, and that's just the committee's feelings on it. Moving on, website. We have a subgroup on the website that's currently furthering our investigation and to give us a product that works for everybody. How many of you are using your phones to look at AM report in the morning? How many of you are using your phones to do a Google search? Well, we want to give you a vehicle that supplies the Four Seasons information on your iPhone, your Samsung, your tablets, and we want it to be consistent. So we're having to switch the architecture of the website to meet those future demands. Moving on, ESC Donor Board. We have submitted a proposal to the board that the ESC Donor Board be modified slightly because it's currently not being utilized. There's a big history to it. And we want to retain that history and present it in a way that's aesthetically pleasing to everybody. So that's in front of the board right now. Style guide. Style guide's a big project that it's gonna take a long time to put together. But basically, we're gonna have a product that's gonna help us understand how everything is going to look when it comes to communicating information, whether it's the website, the AM report, or anything else that pops into our governance. That's it. Any questions? Okay.
You need your approval for your latest member.
On page 37, On page 37 is the recommendation to appoint Martha Baumgarten to the committee.
Martha.
I want to be official.
Oops.
I'll motion to approve Martha Baumgarten.
Second. Moved and seconded to accept Martha Baumgarten onto the Communications Committee. All in favor?
Aye.
What position will she have?
Well, she's going to be the one that's in charge of the style guide for right now and anything else we give her that we can think of. We like to delegate.
Website and monthly article.
That too, yeah. Any other questions? Are we going to get to the next one, the proposal?
Not yet.
Should I leave?
No.
Have a seat. All right, page 38 is the Communication Committee Charter. Randy, were there any amendments to the committee charter, communication charter, or was this just provided for information?
What you're looking at, well, I don't know what you're looking at.
What you submitted.
What I submitted before. You guys didn't get to it last month?
Probably not.
I thought it was written pretty well. You want me to get back up? I can defend it, but I don't remember what I said.
I make a motion to approve the communications committee charter, even though Randy doesn't know what it says.
I'll second that.
The move and second is that we accept the communications committee charter dated 9/14 this year. All in favor?
Aye.
So let it be written, so let it be done.
Okay, our next committee is the Community Planning and Transition Committee.
I'm Willis Fagan, chairman of this committee. We have been working on so many things that time would not permit me to list them all. But one of the most important things is that we want to communicate with homeowners. Two-way communication. Get information from homeowners and give information to homeowners regarding what we're doing. And we're going to start with the homeowners who are already active in our community. Those who are in clubs, interest groups, maybe not in any club or interest group, but they walk the trails, they use the swimming pools and things like that. And this way we can get started sooner than later in touching bases with everybody. We have a plan already in motion. Lynn doesn't even know about it yet, but he's been promoting it, telling us to hurry up. And we've been discussing things among ourselves, committee members, trying to get things going. We have proposed another committee member that I hope you will accept today, Ed Pauls. And we have actually Colin Taylor is our co-chairman, and Pat Wayne is just walked in. She's on our committee. So we're forming our committee and we're getting going. It's very exciting, lots of work. I didn't know I was going to spend 10 hours a day working on stuff when I got on this committee, but it's a lot of work. We are going to have acoustic testing done in the ballroom, in the lobby area and bistro, and in that very echoey chamber over there called Recreation Center North. And we're going to find out what we need to do professionally to help control the reverberation in these spaces. And I think that'll be a big help. I don't know if anybody has questions, but that's my report for today.
I'll make a motion to approve Ed Pauls to be appointed to the CPAT committee.
Second. Moved and seconded to appoint Ed Pauls to the Community Planning and Transition Committee. And what will his job be? What will his job be?
Ed's job will be, he will be focusing on the transition, the finances, governing documents, all those kinds of things. That's his specialty. He's very well qualified to do that. We're very fortunate to have someone like that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, our next committee is the Emergency Preparedness Committee.
Thank you. One thing I'll say is that I received a resignation letter from Dick Van Bree today, so you could probably change the board up there to eliminate him. I'll forward that as soon as I can. I just got it before I came here. You know, as many know, he moved from the communities. Some of the things I'd like to touch on, the City of Beaumont CERT training is full. And there is a waiting list. They expect the next training to be in spring of 2017. We are encouraging them to have more frequent trainings. And I know several people from this community are involved in the one that's going to occur this month. leading up to that, the Bogart fire that we had here recently in the hills above Cherry Valley, one of the problems that they expressed was untrained volunteers, and that's why we encourage everyone to go to CERT training and have some knowledge of what it takes to respond in emergencies. We do have a position within our action plan that is called volunteer coordinator, who can take those people that come up just to volunteer and organize them and see what skills they have that we might use and see if we can channel their help. But just to have people respond with no knowledge of our chain of command, our structure, organizational structure, that can be a problem, and that's what they experienced on the Bogart fire. We did have Al Getman come to our meeting and talk about the community maps, and we're in the process of getting a good coordination between Neighborhood Watch and EPC to use the same mapping system. The EPP training that's been on AM report, and I think there's brochures out on October 20th at 10 a.m. will be a little more than what we said would be the dual track. It's going to kind of be a three-track system. We're going to have some training on first aid, then we'll do the Great California Shakeout Drill, and then we'll have some training on the FRS radios. So that's going to be a good training for people to attend and get some real good information. The revised EPC charter, I would recommend that you table that. I think if there's changes to term limits, there probably will need to be changes to it, so I would prefer that you not make a decision on that. And then we are going to have a subcommittee planning a disaster drill after the first of the year, obviously, and so we're working on that. Our next meeting is the 18th in RCN conference room at 10 o'clock, and we urge people to come. We also are recommending Alfred Blair to be appointed to the committee. He'll be taking Dick Van Bree's spot as the communication manager. So we'd appreciate the approval of Al today.
I'd like to make a motion that we approve Alfred Blair on the committee, EPA committee.
A second. It's been moved and seconded to accept Alfred Blair onto the Emergency Preparedness Committee. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
May I ask a question?
Did you want to recognize a homeowner?
Okay.
Yes.
Sure.
Or make a statement, I guess. I've been searching for a very long time, as have many of my people who live here. I find if we could get more follow-up training involved in subsequent years, because if I could hardly remember my address, 2 minutes after I leave the house, I'm not sure I'm going to remember all the things I learned in search training.
Now, they have in the past offered refreshers.
Yes.
And then we've been discussing it and talking about trying to get a CERT coordinator as part of our structure and our committee so that we can track CERT trained people better and then provide maybe some additional training. But coming to the October 20th training would be a good benefit for anyone that currently has CERT that would like some refresher in first aid and radio.
So that people who are
pre-trained
can show up?
Oh, sure. That's the October 20th training is for any citizen that wants to come, any residents. And it's here.
Okay. I'm confused if it's full.
No, CERT is full, but the October 20th is a training put on by the EPC committee.
Oh, I see
committee.
What you're talking
about. Okay, I think we need to move on.
Thank you, sorry.
Okay, our next committee is facilities.
Good afternoon, Dan Bushman with the Facilities Committee. As everybody knows, we had a sad breakup with safety last month. So our most important and first order of business in our last meeting was to elect Bill Guy as our chair and Doug Smith as our co-chair. Our next meeting will be Tuesday, November 1st. And I want to let everybody know, since the split with safety, we do have openings. So if you're interested, please put in an application and come attend our next meeting.
Next committee is finance.
I'm Don Fan, chairman of the finance committee. Last meeting was September 27th. reviewed the August financial statements, and I'll share a few numbers with you. Income for the month of August, actual was $345,784, budget $355,573, variance under budget of $97,89. Year-to-date income, actual $2,715,493, budget $2,859,376, variance under budget of $143,883. Expenses for the month, actual $372,358. Budget was $371,105 with a variance of $1,253 over budget. Year to date, actual $2,602,182. Budget $2,840,419 with a variance under budget of $238,237. We had six homeowners present at our meeting, and in addition, our esteemed chairperson, Lynn Travernetti. Claudine was out of town. Tom Moe was accepted as co-chair on our committee. We had 12 vendor proposals reviewed. 10 were recommended forward for board approval. Noel Myers and Georgia Coleman agreed and volunteered to review upcoming vendor contracts. Springdale Front Yard Cost Center 2017 budgets were reviewed and accepted, forwarded to the board for approval. The proposed 2017 reserve study changes that we had made from the prior month were all accepted by SCT Reserve Consultants and also forwarded to the board for approval. Our town hall meeting was a week ago, Tuesday, on October 4th. Dues were recommended to remain the same. The turnout at the town hall meeting was a little bit light. It was the same night as Hillary and the other Donald. He won. Our next meeting is October 25th at 1 o'clock. We welcome any homeowners who'd like to come and join us. Questions, comments from the board?
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Okay, our next committee is the Landscape Committee.
Members, and we meet the second and fourth Monday of each month at 8 a.m. Sharon Bonds is our co-chair. I want to acknowledge and give a big thanks to all those who were involved and worked hard to achieve a big success in the adopting.
Power, please.
Okay. Put your mouth to it.
That's right. I'll start again. I want to acknowledge and give a big thanks to all those who were involved and worked hard to achieve a big success in the enacting of our trails to meet the needs of our homeowners who rely on mobility devices, which are mobile wheelchairs. We celebrated this day Thursday, September 29th of this year with a ribbon-cutting ceremony and a photo shoot which produced a great turnout. This truly was a great day and a memorable event. That's pretty much it for now. Any questions? Thank you.
Okay, our next committee is the Rules and Regulations Committee.
Good afternoon. Okay, we've actually had two meetings since the last board meeting, and at the meeting we have made or developed changes to the election rules, which will be presented in the later in the meeting as proposals. One member has resigned, and it will be hard to replace Louise Lyons. Her background and knowledge is something that we really can't do without. Anyway, it will be very hard to fill her chair. Thanks, Louise. Also, we have been discussing changes in the reservation for the summit, but you guys will have to come to the next meeting to find out what those changes are, because it won't come up until then. So I'll give you a reason to show up next month. Anyway, our next meeting will be on November 8th at 9 a.m. and in the Rec Center Norman Thomas Room. Thank you.
Thank you.
Carol, are we going to go through the recommendations now?
New business.
Under new business. Okay, we'll call you back up. Don't leave.
Melissa's still here, he's just hiding.
Our next committee is the safety committee.
We had our first meeting of the safety committee on 4 October 2016 at, we have to translate this back in real time, 1 p.m., sorry. 1300 comes to mind, but people don't understand that. We had three of us who had come over from the facility that Scott Britton, Anita Worthen, and myself. We had a review of the charter just in draft. I think we'll get that probably worked out by the next meeting. There was some good input into that. We had some additional initial agenda items that we want to start looking at in terms of safety issues for the community, and that's some of those just like fencing and some of the security gates and some of the way the bushes are designed for the entryway, that type of thing, because it does create a problem and safety is not being able to see. So we're working on that. That'll be some of our initial agenda items on that. There's a traffic survey or a traffic study that we'll be working on, at least that will be coming forth later on. We'll look at that too, because you can't have a traffic study, you can't have law enforcement in here under contract doing any type of citations or any type of traffic enforcement without the traffic survey study, so that will be pending. There were two other members that we have for the we interviewed, and we asked that you'll be having those before you hear. That will be Donna Lewis, and she will be secretary, somebody who can spell. And she's very, very well versed in writing as compared to some of the other scribes, which I've done, which needs to be done much better. And also Jeff Wilson. And our next meeting will be 1 November 2016 at 1 o'clock. Did I do that wrong?
I did that wrong.
Okay, so
it's
really
1 o'clock.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay, because you had those two members.
We did not get the recommendations in the packet for those two members.
Sorry about that.
That's okay. Did the board want to go ahead and make a motion to appoint them?
I'd like to make a motion to appoint both Donna and
Jeff.
Donald
Lewis
and Jeff Wilson.
It's been moved and seconded to appoint two new members to the safety committee. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you for the additional questions.
Okay, our next committee is the social committee.
My name is Betty Ann James, and I'm a member of the Social Committee, not an officer. I'd like to let you know that we have updated our committee charter. We've also appointed Pam Morales as our co-chair. And we're also planning our New Year's entertainment. And that's going to be very exciting in that we've hired Las Vegas entertainers. And also Tony, our DJ, will be back this year. So it will be Viva Las Vegas entertainment, and we're continually planning. Now the ticket sales will be in November 1st, but the time will be later determined by the committee, and there will be posters around and also the telephone and so forth. We're finalizing our 2017 calendar, and we've had lots of suggestions opposing the dinner dance concept, so we're looking at some other options, and we're open to suggestions. Our next meeting, however, will be, November 14th, because we had some conflict of members being there, and we needed to have a quorum, so that meeting will be November 14th at 1 p.m. I also have a proposal here for the board. It's our annual Make-A-Wish project that we do. And it is the time of the year, and the Winter Wish Program wheel are turning and quickly preparing for the school children that are in our area. We've done this for the past 9 years, and we would like to continue it. And we would also like for the members here and the residents to participate in bringing clothing and also food. We will have a tree in the lobby, as we always have, and those will be taken off. And this is a great need to our community. It's extending our heart to the heart of the community. And we'd like for you to approve that. This is our proposal.
We're going to call you back up during new business.
I'm sorry?
We'll call you back up during new business for the proposal.
Yeah.
Oh. This is my first time. Okay, I don't know if there's anything else that you need to know at this time. Okay, great.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the proposed social committee charter.
Second.
And proposed and seconded to approve the social committee charter. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
I'd also like to make a motion to approve Marianne Heron as the newest member of the social committee.
Second.
Second. Moved and seconded to accept Marianne Harris onto the social committee. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Okay, next committee is the Ad Hoc Technology Committee.
Real quick, I'll give you this. These are reports for the work that was done here. If anybody wants to look at those, I apologize. I just got back from a tour of the Deep South last 2 weeks. Got in late last night. And I just wanted to... Did you want to bring that up about the reimbursements? Should I do that?
That's new business.
Don't worry, you're good. You're good. Keep going. They helped out packing, so you're good.
Okay, so then you understand that according to the package, we had a survey here. It was very impromptu, but we had really no time. This fellow works for Disney. He works sound and acoustics. He's going to be in China this next year. Very talented young man. He's the son-in-law of one of the members of the tech committee, and we had 3 dates that he could come. One date, the bottle wasn't open. Another date was a conflict for me. He became the third date, stayed here, worked on all of our sound equipment. He's an amazing expert. He tuned all of our amplifiers, preamps, the speakers. He worked on those. He worked on the microphones. So he did a lot of work, and it was impromptu. I didn't have authorization. But I fronted the money because I thought it was really beneficial. I've talked to half a dozen people that listened to all this after the work was done. They thought that the sound here is much better than it used to be. So that's my presentation for the reimbursement. SG.
Question? Can't hear you.
Do you want us to approve your new committee charter?
I'm sorry, what did you say?
We'll hold off on that.
Okay, so...
No questions.
Is there a question over the reimbursement for the money that I put out?
It's in new business. That's not at this time.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Thank you, Larry. Did our community ambassador want to come up and give a report? Anita?
Here's the report from Miss Ambassador. We did a lot. Actually, we have so much more to do. And everybody was looking for the visit from the Beaumont City officials. And of course, you know, it was canceled, but basically, it was the same night as the upcoming presidential debate. So it's going to be rescheduled sometime in November or the future. So we just want to let everyone know. That's the reason, and the city officials were coming to talk about the CDF funds as well. So the new city manager will be coming in, and I'm talking to the old city manager and some of the other officials. The Beaumont Police POW-MIA escort, and that happened on September the 16th. I went to the city council meeting the following Tuesday to thank the Beaumont Police for coming out and helping us. And the three officers that came was Sergeant Harris, Officer Lunt, and Detective Prieta. I gave that information to the chief of police, which is Sean Police, and he was very happy that we appreciated what they were doing. Speaking of the Beaumont K-9 unit, Detective Prieta, we have been talking to him to come, and unfortunately, we didn't have the correct telephone number. He never got any of the messages that we left, so he gave me his personal cell phone, so we'll get him out there with the new puppy we have, which is Mia. So Mia is very puppy-like. The senior transportation meeting, I went to that on behalf of Four Seasons. We did have that ice cream social here, was good, and we had some people that were seeking city council positions coming up. And basically, I'm also representing the veterans as others on the transportation, Riverside County transportation meeting. So that we're working in with Four Seasons on that. I've talked to RTA, Pass Transit, MetroLink, and we're seeing about getting Morongo to come, because Morongo has bought a spur off the railroad tracks. So they're looking at seeing what they can do to increase train traffic. Community volunteers, because there's so much going on in the community, I've asked other people, and I'm asking anyone that want to participate in going and being involved in the community. And that just takes, along as Beaumont, Banning, Riverside, whatever. I've already talked to Sonia Taplin. She has agreed to be a part of that, as well as Susan Wilson. So anyone that want to join me, just let me know. The last is the Veterans Award, which was for our board of director, President Lynn Tabernetti. Unfortunately, it was scheduled for the 18th of October. But due to the deaths of the two Palm Springs officers, because the meeting was going to be held and the awards ceremony with all the supervisors where he would get his award was going to be held in Palm Springs, it's going to be rescheduled to November, and I'll let you know. But I would ask, as a community person and as a mother of a former LA County Sheriff, and for our new people that's coming on, please keep all the law enforcement and the veterans in your prayers. Thank you. Oh, on November 9th, another part of this is everybody's running up on the freeway, and you see all those trucks that's coming in and out. The supervisor of California Highway Patrol will be here on November the 9th, 10 a.m., please come out and see him. He'll talk to you about trucks, and scales, and everything else. Thank you.
Okay, back to our agenda. The next item on our agenda is to review and act upon club or group application requests. We did not receive any this month. So our next item is review and act upon homeowner facility use requests. On page 69 and 70 are two requests. There is no board action required. It's just for information purposes only. And with that, we'll invite Cindy Graves, our activities director, up to give her presentation.
Hello.
3 minutes.
Yes. Start the clock.
Clock is ticking.
Okay. Ready? Mark, what's up?
Go.
Go. All right. Get your little bum bum bump ready.
busy on here. Okay. Craft Boutique, one of my favorite events of all time. Love it. It's this Saturday. Don't forget, all of the neighbors and the surrounding community are going to be there. So get your parking spot first. And of course, remember, you come in here, the entrance is here, remember, and you go through the 60 plus vendors that we have this year, and go out that door, and there's going to be raffles and all the rest of those fun things. Legal raffles. also, pay attention that there will be a possible Machu Picchu music event in the lodge lobby on October 22nd from 4:30 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. So listen carefully to see if the board approves it under new business. Next, Stay Safe class will be happening in the ballroom on Saturday, October 22nd from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Learn about the latest in senior-focused safety techniques to protect yourself from holiday crime. This class is a gift from the HOA, so the price has been paid. Please sign up at the lodge lobby so we know how many to expect, and that's on that big brown table out there. That should be a great class. And don't forget to tell your neighbors about the upcoming committee membership drive, pending board approval, on Thursday, November 3rd, from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. There will most likely be free pizza from Smitty's, as well as refreshing cold water bottles. A raffle will also be held with prizes. Come and find out what your Four Seasons committees are doing and discover where your gifts and talents might fit in. Well, guess what? Match game, if you had a blast last time at Match Game, which so many did, it will be once again in the Lodge Ballroom on Friday, November 4th at 6 p.m. It was such a big hit the last time that we're doing it again. Of course, you can bring your dinners in from Smitty, and we'll have some great contestants, and you get to play along too, so it's fun. And then, I wrote on here, so don't pay attention to it, the Veterans Day program information to be announced, but I have it all solid now. The VFW called and we're good. So make sure that you write down in your calendar to spend, gosh, one little bit of a day to honor our awesome veterans. Just one part of the day during the year. This year, we're focusing on showcasing our World War II guys because they are quickly becoming an extinct breed. Okay, so we want to really showcase those guys and give them the honor that is due them and remember them. Our program is going to be starting at 6 p.m. right here. We have some really cool stories to share with you about some of the folks and their service and what was done on the home front. Cool stories. You won't want to miss it. With our VFW Color Guard. And there is going to be, prior to that, as a little tradition we've sort of started last year, I think was our first tradition, the Honor Walk, Veterans Honor Walk, to put a wreath on our veterans tree that we have. We're going to start at the summit. Anybody meet at the summit at 10:45, and then it's a tiny little walk, like a minute or two, from the summit down to the picnic area. What's the name of that area?
Veterans Park.
What is it?
Veterans Park.
Okay, it's called Veterans Park. But actually, it has a different signage. Do you remember what the signage is? No. Okay. Follow us down, will ya? And we're going to have just a neat commemoration time and place a veterans wreath on our little baby veterans tree that's growing big. So come on down for that. That's at 11:11:11. Isn't that cool? So, meaning 11 fall. I mean, 11. All right. So there we go. Next, club and class events. PAX Love and Marriage Show. Whoop, Michael, who is our director and writer, sitting over there, celeb, green shirt. It will be taking place, the show's going to be taking place Friday, October 28th at 7 p.m. This will be the packed house, and none will be allowed entry without a free ticket given out at the front desk. Free tickets will be given out at the front desk starting Monday, October 17th, so mark that down. You can get it any time during the week, though, okay? This new procedure is to ensure that we have one butt for one seat. We know how upsetting it can be when we reach maximum capacity after you plan on seeing a great job. There's going to be 350 tickets and no dinners, you guys, are going to be allowed during this performance. So come earlier, eat your dinner on the loggia or in the front, and then come on in for the show. There you go. It's going to be great. Make sure you come. Hammerog Group is going to be having a special event in the ballroom on Sunday, October 23rd, from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. Learn about energy, massage tips, and essential oils. That sounds like the club to join. Call Lynn Matthews or ZNAP for more information. And lastly, there will be a line dance party on Friday, November 18th at 5:30 p.m. in the Lodge Ballroom. All are welcome, and you may bring your dinners in for that one. There's no charge to come and dance. Yay! I went fast, guys! We have a crowd there!
Cindy.
Yes, question.
5 o'clock for the line dance.
Okay, 5 o'clock for the line dance. Jot that down. You don't want to miss that. Oh, I forgot to ask it. Do you have any questions? No? All right! Yay! Thank you for coming to the board meeting, people.
Thank you, Cindy. You're only 2 minutes over budget. But you were on a roll, so we let you keep going.
Aw, thank you.
Okay, next item on our agenda is the management report. And on pages 72 through 115 are the management updates and activity log. Did the board have any questions regarding any of those items? We'll go ahead and talk about our statistics report. During the month of September, we started with 201 open issues. We added an additional 307 issues for a total of 508 issues that we were tracking. These included 18 account inquiries. These are your homeowner assessment accounts inquiries. We had 173 concerns submitted. 238 correspondence items. Some of those were made up of our architectural requests. We had 7 general items, 54 projects, and 18 service issues. During the month of September, we were able to respond to 458 of those issues within 2 hours. And then completion statistics, we were able to complete 209 of those within 48 hours. I think that was a pretty good record. Any questions regarding the statistics report? Okay, also there was no communication log submitted this month, so we'll make sure to put both of those in for your review next month. And then we had pages 116 through 186. This included all the communication items for the board's review and consideration. I did not see any that required a decision. Did the board have any questions regarding the communications?
No.
Easy peasy. Okay, so moving on, we did not have any unfinished business, so we're gonna go ahead and start with our new business items. The first item is on page 187 and 188. And this is the recommendation of forming a lodge committee.
Okay, I guess this comes from me. and looking at the issues that we have that are lodge related, in other words, that they spin out of the lodge, quite often the people who are asking questions or have problems or want to make changes, have not had a place to go to where their concern could be addressed and bounced against other things that are ongoing in the lodge, and come forward to the board with a coordinated position on what should be done and recommendation. So my feeling was that if we take everything that's in the lodge, from the billiard room to the spa room to the bistro and everything, and put collectively it under one committee, that could all be done, and there would be a place for everyone to go, including the ad hoc committee. And so I have recommended to the board that we expand the bistro committee, and it's already doing probably the lion's share of the work here anyway, to bring in all the orphans under one tent. And that's the purpose of this proposal.
Do you need a motion for the charter or for the proposal? Charter?
For the charter.
I'd like to make a motion for the revised bistro charter that is now the lodge committee charter.
Second. That's been moved and seconded to revise the charter from the bistro committee to the lodge committee with expanded responsibilities. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Okay, the next item on our agenda is the committee membership drive in the board packet. It's on pages 189 and 190.
Okay. Let's see. We have a motion to approve the club committee. I guess that's
I'll make a proposal.
Membership drive?
I'll make a proposal to approve the committee membership drive proposal.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the committee membership drive on Thursday, November 3rd. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Okay, the next item on our agenda is from the Community Planning and Transition Committee. Willis, if you want to come up and give some information regarding the recommendation for an acoustic test.
There has been a lot of conjecture about what needs to be done in these rooms to reduce reverberation. Let me demonstrate. Dominant also in the lobby area. Do the same thing out there, and it's like an echo chamber. Do the same thing in the RCM building in that central room. It's very noisy in there. The idea is to have outside professional acoustics engineers come in and test these rooms and report to us what needs to be done. They will test this ballroom without the sound system on, with the production speaker system on, and with the ceiling speakers on, three different ways. They will then do their engineering, and they will recommend to us what mitigation we should use in this room to help the reduce the acoustic echo or reverberation. Bass is low frequencies is a very prominent problem in this room. They will also help us address that issue. Same way with the other three places. This is a phased type of thing. Their initial test will just collect data, then they'll go to their office and perform all of their engineering. Then they will come back to us and give us specific recommendations of their findings, not just a bunch of technical information, but recommendations as to what we should do. Does that answer the question?
Is this a reserve item? Would this be me? Would this be a reserve item, Don?
No.
No? It's got a 900 GEO 902.
That's the consultant GEO code.
Okay, consultant. Didn't know.
One more thing. We hope to have all of this done by the end of this month. So it's an urgent thing that we're trying to get done right now. I already have two proposals in my hand for the work to be done, so we're moving ahead on it.
Thank you.
The urgency is created by the fact that we have to have an open window in this ballroom in order to conduct the changes that will come as a result of the test. We have looked at two places on the calendar, one in January and one in February, and by the time we get the results of the test back, do the analysis, make the recommendations, go out for bids, and then it involves carpeting. The carpeting mills shut down toward the end of the year for the Christmas holidays, so we're working on a rather tight schedule to get it done, and that has been compressed, as Willis noted. So once Willis has gathered the results of the test, he'll come forward to the board with recommendations, and then we will probably go to the facilities and the finance committees for execution of the plan. And that's the current schedule we're on right now. We may have to have a special board meeting en route in order to meet our timelines, but that's what we're doing. So
I'll make a motion to approve the acoustic testing of the ballroom at a cost not to exceed $12,000.
Second. Okay, it's been proposed and seconded to approve acoustic testing for a cost not to exceed $12,000. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Okay, the next proposal on our agenda is the ESC Donor Board. Communication. Randy?
Hi.
For those of you who don't know what the donor board is, as you exit that door over there on the wall between the restrooms and Smitty's, there's a board, black and white board. That's called the donor board, and Randy will explain a little more about it.
A long, long time ago, we didn't have the population nor a budget, to do improvements that needed to get done, and they found a way to recognize events, people, things. People wanted to donate in, let's say you lost a spouse or a special animal, and you wanted to donate money, and we knew we could do something with it and use it, and that was to speakers, lighting, multiple things that we did in this area, down at the amphitheater area also. Well, that's no longer used. That donor board is not used anymore, but the recognition of the people that committed funds in the name of something special to them deserves to historically stay here, but we need to reconfigure it slightly and give a little history of what that is. And so we're asking that the board approve us taking the donor board down, redesigning a new board that will go up and be basically a historical document of what transpired up to that point in with all those people that donated funds and what we did with it. Kind of.
The group that did that was known as the Event Systems Committee. It was disbanded about 2 years ago when we no longer needed to accept donations from the members of the community to do this kind of upgrade, mostly acoustical and lighting for the production. And since that time, the board has remained up there, but very few, particularly the newcomers that have arrived, have any idea of what the history is, and we want to capture that history and keep it in a permanent place where we can acknowledge the contributions of the pioneers that came here. So, like, we have a proposal.
I'd like to make a motion that we approve Randy's recommendation for a story plaque describing the history, make the alterations as you described.
It's been moved and seconded that we have the communications committee redesign the donor board and it be placed back up on the wall to remain there. All in favor?
Aye.
Could you get that done?
Thank you, Randy. The next item on the agenda is the battery and solar charging system. This item has been removed from the agenda. That would bring on the painting of the shuffleboard court, and this is the Facilities Committee.
Okay, this was actually tabled quite a long time ago because it's been in such disrepair, but we were under the understanding at that time that the lodge and the surrounding area, the grounds were going to be redone. Obviously, that's not going to happen anytime soon. So therefore, because of some homeowner requests that have been made, we revisited this. The concrete is cracked out there. The paint lines are very difficult to see. And so we'd like to have this done now. Total cost would be $3,130.
I'd like to make a recommendation, a proposal that we accept the vendor A, which is the lowest bidder.
I'll second.
Okay. Plan B is chalk?
Yeah, okay.
It's been proposed and seconded that we approve painting of the shuffleball court. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is the Summit Pool window tent.
Okay, and here we have the windows up at the summit. You get a severe glare in there at certain times of the day. So we would like to have those windows tinted to reduce that glare. The total cost for that would be $1,296.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept the proposal for $1,296 for the window tinting at the summit.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that we approve tinting of the west windows at the Summit Pool. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next item on the agenda is the Summit Bocce Court upgrade.
Okay, we have been working on this, as Mike said earlier, for months and months and months and months. It is needed for various reasons. First of all, the courts up there are almost unplayable at this point because they're so uneven. But beyond that, and more importantly probably, is the safety issue. We'd like to make the court safe for our, especially for our wheelchair residents. So we have submitted a court upgrade for and bunch of ball scoreboards. Court upgrade is a cost of $31,500. And the scoreboards would be a total for two of them of $928.
Again, I'd like to make a motion that we accept vendor C's proposal. We're doing the court upgrade and the bocce scoreboards.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the proposal to upgrade the bocce courts at the summit for cost of $31,500. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And two scoreboards.
And the scoreboards for $928. Yes.
Next proposal on the agenda is the automatic door openers at the summit.
Oh gosh, Eric, I need help on this. The ADA door openers are not powerful enough right now. The ones we have, I believe they're battery operated and they're not powerful enough to open the doors currently. So we're recommending two commercial grade openers similar to the ones at the lodge. And the cost on this would be $6,495.84.
I'll motion that we approved not to exceed $6,495.84 for the summit automatic door opener.
I second. It's been moved and seconded that we approve the automatic door opener facilities being approved at the summit for a cost not to exceed $6,495.84. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Good job. That's it.
Thank you.
For facilities. Next on our agenda is the review and act upon the CPA year-end review and tax preparation proposal. Dawn.
Exciting.
somehow ends up in my corner every year. We had four proposals, one from Frisbee Carter Associates, $1,500. Another Newman Associates, $1,200. Robert A. Owens for $1,750. Vanderpool and Company of $2,025. The last several years has been done by Vanderpool and Company, and I don't know, for some reason they raised their prices a little bit on us this year, so we really couldn't justify that. Robert A. Owens had negative feedback from one of our committee members, so we crossed him off the list. That left Frisbee Carter and it left Newman, and we're recommending to go with the vote of Newman and Associates.
Make a recommendation that we accept the proposal for the year-end review tax.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded that Newman and Associates be contracted with to complete a review and tax preparation in the amount of $950. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Okay, the next proposal on our agenda is approval of the 2017 reserve study. Don, you're getting your steps in today.
As you know, we spent a lot of time on the reserve study. In the last few weeks, we went through virtually every line item. We made recommendations for changes, and SCT consultants accepted those changes. The final draft is, I believe, in front of you now, but for your approval, we recommend approval.
I make a recommendation that we accept the 2017 reserve study prepared and reviewed by the Finance Committee.
I second. It's been moved and seconded that we accept the reserve study prepared by SCT Reserve Consultants for fiscal year 2017. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
And the last item for finance is to review and act upon the 2017 proposed budget.
This is primarily acting upon the budget data. First of all, the master budget is prepared by K-Hub Nutting Consultants. Our committee, Noel Myers, prepared the 2017 budgets for Front Yard Cost Center and Springdale's. We therefore have forwarded those on for your review and approval.
I make a recommendation that we accept both the Front Yard and the Springdale budgets for 2017 prepared by the Finance Department.
I'll second that. Those budgets, by the way, were prepared with no change in due structure. Dues will remain the same as they were in prior years.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded that we accept the 2017 budget recommendations from the Finance Committee. All in favor?
Aye.
So we'll see if there's any objections from the homeowners first.
I'll just make a comment, please. All of you, the Finance Department spent a lot of time in all three of those issues, and I think they should be commended for their time and effort.
Okay, on to our Landscape Committee. Richard, if you want to join us. On the agenda is to review and act upon Tract 33096-7, Landscape Maintenance Acceptance and Proposal. And there is a correction. It does say that they recommend Brad Alms Landscaping. That's incorrect. It's actually O'Connell Landscaping, and the amount is $2,800, not $3,750.
Other than that, it's perfect.
Everything that is perfect.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Recommendation, proposal?
I'll recommend that we accept the proposal of O'Connell for the amount specified.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded that we accept the landscape maintenance proposal for track number 33096-7. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next item on the agenda is the Kikuyu grass removal.
You pronounce that pretty good, Jerry.
I practiced all day.
Kikuyu grass is invasive an unwanted grass species that has started to spread on a few homes in Kettle Creek. The Landscape Committee recommended to accept O'Connell's proposal for removing the Kiki grass and resodding lawn at 177 and 181 Kettle Creek. The total cost, $925.
This is the light-colored grass, Bob?
Yeah.
Correct, yeah. It's a very fine, light-colored grass. It almost looks like weeds growing in the grass, and it's been a problem here for years, and we have to eradicate it.
I'll make a motion that we accept a bid, and see if I can pronounce it, to remove the Kukuya grass from the landscape for $925.
I move and second it that we remove the Kukuya grass as indicated. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next item on the agenda is the Trail C entrance plant installation.
The east side of Four Seasons next to the Trail C entrance does not have enough foliage or aesthetics. Landscape Committee recommends accepting Brad Holmes' proposal for installing 30 wax rivets, hyper-fumed in front of A3 15-gallon bushes. Total cost, $775.
I'll make the motion to accept that bid for the Trail C entrance plan installation at $775.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that we accept Brad Holmes' proposal for installing new plants on the Trail C entrance. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next item on the agenda is the Summit Entry Plant installation.
There are several bare spots in front of the summit that need a variety of plants to make the area look better. The committee recommends accepting Brad Holmes' bill for 405-gallon plants. Total cost, $825.
I'll make the motion that we accept the bid proposal for the Summit Entry Plant installation for $825.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded that we accept the installation for the replacement, I think it is, of plants at the Summit grounds in the bare spots and add color and variety. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you, Richard.
Thank you.
Next item on our agenda is the district redistribution and the recommendations from the Rules and Regulations Committee. Carol?
The current boundaries have been created so that we can propose those and have, I don't know what we're doing, this is yours. Jerry did this. Anyway, we're proposing these to go to KCOG that they can put forth these and have them changed and they will do it at their cost so that we don't have to. And the districts have been realigned so that they're more equal as far as homes.
I make a motion to reestablish the delegate districts and maintain a total membership per district of approximately 100 homes.
A second. It's been moved and seconded to propose to the builder that we redesign the district map so that each district delegate has approximately 100 homes in it. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next item on our agenda is the elimination of cumulative voting.
Currently, when we vote on an election, the voters can have as many votes as there are open positions. The committee is recommending changing this to create one vote per household, no matter how many open positions there are. That way it won't look like if you have four open positions on the board and they go ahead and somebody in votes all four votes rather than spreading them out for four people, all four vote for one person, it kind of skews the look or the tally. It looks like some people have 1,000 votes and other people have 500 or whatever. This way it'll be more equitable and you can actually see who people are voting for.
Okay, Carol, I understand that what we really wanted to do was to not limit the household to four votes, just limit them from voting four times for one person. Is that correct?
We just want one vote per household, no matter how many, just...
Not one vote per candidate?
No, one vote per household. We discussed it. There was no way to actually do what you're saying.
Well, when we vote in state or county, it'll say, vote for any four judges. You can only vote, you know...
One judge is running.
And you still get all the votes, but you can't pool them all for one person.
True.
I don't understand why we can't say the same thing to the candidates. If you have six candidates and you have four votes, you can vote for...
But if we had six candidates, then we would normally have six votes.
No, no, not if you have four positions. If you only have four open board positions and you have six candidates, you should still have four votes.
Why?
This won't allow you to do that.
I know that. I'm asking you why you think that it should be that way.
Oh, I don't think you should. Yeah, I think apparently the legal people have told us that nobody else has done it that way, or what?
We've actually received a legal opinion, a verbal legal opinion from our council that in our community association industry, there's two types of voting, cumulative voting and standard voting, which is one vote per household. We would be doing something different.
Great.
That's right.
I think we ought to pursue doing something different.
Right, those two options were what was presented to the Rules and Regs Committee.
Yeah.
And so they reviewed both options, and this was their recommendation.
Yeah, but we didn't review a third option.
Correct.
I think we should. I think if there's four people running for two seats, you should still get two votes.
Okay. And your recommendation then would be that that no one person can receive more than one vote, right?
Mm-hmm. Per household.
Per household.
Yeah.
I have no. We tried that, but I was told it, so whatever.
So, Jerry, do we need to take this back to legal for their? Since it's a new way of doing something?
I think we should get their recommendation. Depending on what the direction the board is, whether they accept this recommendation or a different recommendation, the sooner the better, because obviously he has to prepare all the legal paperwork. This will be an amendment to our governing documents, and so we should take it back and get his feedback on either can it or can it not be done, and if not, why.
So I make a motion that we pen the current rules and regulations proposal to eliminate cumulative voting until we can take the third option to our attorney court.
It'll just be tabled. There's not necessary. We'll just table it.
Okay.
Okay, the next item on our agenda is the elimination of the district delegate voting system.
We recommend that we eliminate the district delegate system, creating a committee with two representatives from each district to assist with reaching a community-wide quorum to be met. This will eliminate the possibility that a delegate can cast the entire district's power as if the district does not, if the district does not be quorum. Which, lately we have had quorum, but there has been times when we have not met quorum. That would allow that one district delegate to cast all that district's votes for any person that they chose, regardless on how the people within the district voted, because they have no way of really knowing, because those votes would not be open. Those ballots wouldn't be open.
And this is a CC&R change? Motion.
Scott, I got a question. How would it work then? Say an election comes up. How are these two people for district determined? Are they volunteers to come forward and say, I'll volunteer my time?
Right.
Yes. It would just be a committee of people that are saying, we're going to help get the vote out, basically.
And it would save money to the HOA by not having a district delegate election?
Absolutely.
So it sounds like it might be streamlining the operation. I'll make a motion that we approve it as presented.
I'll second.
You will be on the upcoming election? It'll take us beyond.
Right,
be the next time.
Yeah. It's been proposed and seconded to eliminate the district delegates and allow direct voting community-wide. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next item on the agenda is the media usage during the election process.
Okay. What? You were vocal on this before. Any article to appear, any article which will appear in the association's printed media will be limited to 100 words. Any article on the association's website shall be limited to 400 words and one graphic or one picture. All articles must include the author's name. Any submission may be posted up to 60 days prior to the election and will appear for a period of 3 business days.
How would this affect the AM report?
It would affect the AM report. Well, right now on the AM report, we're using links to go to another page.
So there'd be maybe a link on the AM report, but not the 400 words.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll make a motion to limit the association printed media during elections as proposed.
Second. It's been moved and seconded to establish limits on the association's printed and electronic media during elections. As stated, all in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Next item on our agenda is the canvassing during the election process.
Okay. There's been many comments in regards to canvassing. Unlimited canvassing has caused several concerns from homeowners over unwanted visits and materials left at their residences. Committee recommends that neither a candidate nor any homeowner shall canvass individual homeowners door to door. Before I hear any, wait, please, let me, I still have some more to say. On this particular proposal, it was discussed greatly. We heard from practically everybody on how everybody was open and willing to have people come forth. However, people might be open and willing to your face, but then we get down here and the same people are calling Jerry and complaining that their people are there at their door, they're leaving stuff on the doorstep, and they're down yelling at our front desk and it's Cindy. So I know that people are saying one thing to your face and something else, and I know that it's a great opportunity to go out and meet people and do that. However, I don't think you should have to have this to go out and meet the homeowners or the constituents in this community. There's a lot of other opportunities for the election meeting that take place. We have the meet and greets in people's homes. We have, they can use any facility within the community to do that at no charge to them, to hold meetings and meet people. This is just, there's people that say they don't care, there's people that say they do care. This is just something that we really need to take a look at.
First, I think we have to bring it to the table and say, so let's get the proposal up first. Would someone like to propose we look at limiting canvassing during elections?
I have a question.
Point of order is you have a motion and a second, and then you have discussion.
Yeah, we can have the discussion once the motion's on the table. If we don't put the motion on the table, we don't have the discussion.
Okay, I'll make a motion. I'd like to discuss this.
Yeah. Second?
I'll do a second.
Okay, the movement seconded that we discuss the canvassing during election process. Red?
Okay. I'm guilty of the sin of canvassing. My wife and I went around to over 1,000 homes in the heat of the summer, dragged her along, and I found it an interesting experience. We knocked on the door, we met people. Many of the people we met were housebound people. People who don't get out, people who don't drive. Some of them just wanted to talk, and we can do that. I think there's there's a variety, I think there's a lot of middle ground, middle maneuvering. For example, that little logo you have up there could be smaller or make a happy face or a frown, put it in the bill mailer, and that person puts it in their window by the front door. If there's a halt, you skip that house. You don't go there. But others, they like to hear the issues. They may not have time to go out and go to all the meet and greets. So I'm guilty of doing that. I didn't leave any paraphernalia, any campaign material on the front step. But we found it a great way to meet people, some of the new people here and some of the people that have been here a while.
Why do you only go meet people at election time?
Well, Claudine?
Yes. I found that a lot of people that work during the work days were home on Saturday and Sunday and appreciated the fact that we took the time to come to their homes and introduce ourselves and talk about the issues which we individually felt were issues and not about other people, about the other candidates. And in that whole time, and I spent a lot of time, I had one person tell me, please don't. Now, my feeling is, if you don't want to talk to me, you don't want me at your house, tell me that with a sign or have something, say, please have something, please say, well, somebody else came to your door. When I saw something that, or a door was closed, I did not leave literature. Accidentally, one was left, but not by me. And I appreciated meeting them. I met a lot of good people. And the people were appreciative of knowing that we cared enough to spend our time, and it was hot when we walked, spend our time visiting them at their home. And a lot of them, there's a lot that do work, and they were happy that we took this time and not just ignored them during the weekday.
And you know, I'm going to speak to the new homeowners because that's where I canvassed the majority of my canvassing, and they didn't know, they weren't aware of the meetings and the things, because they just moved in or they barely got their feet wet, and they were very appreciative to hear that a board member, potential board member, would come around and speak with them as well. So the new homeowners that I met with enjoyed the opportunity to speak to a candidate.
I agree so far with what's been said, and I have one other question. Do we have any legal issues barring people from going door-to-door on a political campaign?
Legal counsel said that you could prohibit canvassing during, as requested, during the election process. The question was whether you were willing to show up on the 6 o'clock news by putting that rule into effect.
That's what I thought.
Let me add a couple of points here. Claudine and I ran during the normal cycle, which means we canvassed in March, mostly, a little bit in April. The other members here ran in the height of 2 months and the national elections. And there was campaign saturation on television and the news, you know. And yeah, with four members running, and most of them had, all of them really had helpers out there doing it too. There was no sign that you could put up there. And again, when we have the district delegates go out and say, you haven't voted, oh yes I have, oh well sorry. We didn't have any way of doing that. I think if we were to take a good hard look at how we can let everybody get those if they want them, and if they have completed their ballot and sent it back in, we give them a card that says I voted, that's something we put out. You can put that on your window. We can cut down on the number of doorbell ringers. And I think we ought to at least hold off on something like this until we are built out. Because as the Jeanne points out, the new people that move in aren't going to get invited to the teas and the coffees and everything because they don't know anybody. Nobody knows them. And I would worry that if you're the district delegate going around trying to knock on doorbells, you're going to get caught up in this. If you're the person who's trying to put on a tee and you go around and knock on doors, you're going to get caught up in this. So I sympathize with your committee for having to put up with all this because I realize that I'm going to file a lawsuit follows anything you say. And it's well-meaning, and I understand it, but I think we ought to not do it right now.
Maybe you should only vote.
I agree with you.
I agree with you. Concurs? Okay, so we won't vote on that.
Well, you take a vote, and nobody...
I made a motion, yeah.
Okay. That's on the table. All in favor? Motion fails.
Okay. Thank you, Carol.
That's a blemish on your record.
Okay, the next item on our agenda is the winter wish from the Social Committee. Betty Ann.
Every year, for the past 9 years, and I have had to... For the past 9 years, the Social Committee has sponsored a Make-A-Wish program that asks the residents here at Four Seasons to be generous with clothing and food for our members in the community. Do you need background on all that?
No, I'll make a motion to accept the proposal for the Winter Wish from the Social Committee.
I'll second that.
Moved and seconded that we approve the Winter Wish program for this year. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the ballroom sound and lighting assessment from the Ad Hoc Technical Committee.
To explain that a little bit before, do we need more discussion? Do I need to say more than I did before?
We have a proposal to approve reimbursing Larry $300.
Right.
I make a motion to reimburse Larry for the $300 for the ballroom sound light.
Second. Moved and seconded to reimburse Larry for the funds he expended at $300 for ballroom lighting assessment. Favor?
Aye.
Larry approves.
Thank you, Larry. Next is the animal blessing by the dog owners group.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for an opportunity to present our very first dog owners group proposal to the board of directors. And it is for a blessing of the animals. As some of you may know, depending on your tradition and your background, October is the celebration month for St. Francis, the patron saint of animals. And one of the special traditions, both within the church and in the secular world, is the blessing of the animals. And it's a very emotional, very fine tradition. And we are proposing October 29th at 8 a.m. You have some details on your proposal, so I won't go through all of them here. But this would coincide with our weekly Saturday morning pack walk. For those of you who don't know, we've been conducting pack walks now since the month of March, twice a week, without incidents. It's all leashed dogs, and they're very fun, and we haven't had any issues with that. What we would like to do is open this up to all the pet owners in the community. It's not exclusive to DOG members. We even propose allowing cat owners, or if you have other cool pets, I don't know, some people have tortoises and birds and such as that, to come down and receive a blessing from our own Jean Lauren. She is a non-denominational minister who would be conducting this. We also would have with us two certified dog trainers. We have other members of our group who are very experienced in handling dogs and making sure we don't have any issues. In talking to Jean about her experience with these events, she indicates that there has never been any kind of safety issue with the dogs, and we have gotten pretty good at handling our dogs in our group. What we're basically proposing is permission to erect a pop-up, with some seasonal decor on it as the, you know, to cover the blessing area. And we also propose keeping, you know, the waiting dog separate from the dog or other animal that's being blessed. And the area that we have in mind, although as you'll note here, we're open to anything that the board feels would be a more appropriate location, is the front lawn area of the lodge here, kind of near the fountains. Because there's parking, it's easy for anybody who has a mobility device or any kind of other
handicapped to get in there to park. We would keep the dogs away. As I mentioned, there's a nice natural barrier with the curb there. I also want to say that, you know, we want to promote this within the rules and regs of the committee. We have very actively promoted reinforcement of all the rules in the community pertaining to dogs especially. And unlike some of these other things, there is zero cost to the association. We've got everything going on. Reverend Lauren has kindly offered to donate her services for this. And so there would be no cost. We would handle all of the setup, all of the cleanup, and, you know, take care of business as we always have been as a dog owners group. So we very much appreciate your considering our request and hope that we can get a thumbs up.
Sir, proposal?
I'll make a proposal, a motion for the animal blessing for the dog owners group to be approved on for October 29, 2016. I understand there's no cost to the association, staff time or others, so I think it's a good event.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve the animal blessing on the lodge grounds. As part of discussion, has this been presented to any committee?
No.
Okay, I have a concern. I have a concern that there could be a safety issue, that there could definitely be a landscape issue. You're going to go onto the grass area, that the sprinklers could go on in the middle of your ceremony.
Okay.
So what I would propose is that we approve it conditionally, that your group meet with two of our board members who are responsible for safety and landscape, and the social committee to make sure that it doesn't conflict with anything else that might be going on that same day, and subject to their approval, you are approved. So if we can approve the animal blessing as amended, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you very, very much for being here. Well done.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is the booster pump service. This is being proposed from management. Currently, we have 13 irrigation booster pumps that have not routinely received service in the past 10 years. These pumps are used to increase the water pressure as irrigation leaves the line or travels up the lines and travels up the hills, travels up the hill towards Mesa Verde, that area. Due to the lack of water pressure and fuel modification zone in the western half of Trail C, there may be pumps that are in need of repair. We went out and we did get a proposal from Eagle Pump Services, and the proposal to service and provide small repairs is a total of $2,860. Cahab Manion has also committed to assisting with some of the repairs if needed. It's our recommendation that the board approve this proposal.
Make a recommendation that we approve the booster pump service.
Second. We move and second to approve the pump booster pump service contract. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next proposal is the facility holiday hours. Every year the board approves the holiday hours for the following year. We've included a copy of the proposed 2017 holiday hours schedule, and you'll find that on page 272. It's similar to last year. There is no change to last year's schedule.
I make a motion to accept the proposal for the 2017 holiday hours.
I'll second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve the holiday hour schedule. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Okay, so this is all of your first time at approving the annual disclosure report and budget policy. So bear with me, because you guys have to go through this policy and make sure you are selecting the sections of the report that will be going out with our annual budget and exhibits. So beginning on page 273, these, you'll see the choices. You'll see choice A or choice one, choice two. So we'll go through this as quickly as I can. This talks about the pro forma operating budget for fiscal year 2017 prepared on an accrual basis. Choice one is the monthly assessment will remain at, or choice two is, it talks about a monthly increase or decrease. So this would be choice one. You could do this, the motion will be all one at the end of the, at the end of the choice.
When we approved the budget.
Yes.
That figure was on slide.
Yes.
Didn't we, should that number be in here?
This is a draft, and so we did not drop any of the answers into it. So, the monthly assessment will remain at $210 for the master assessment, $52 for the front yard cost center, and the variable assessment for the Springdales. It will remain the same as it was in 2016.
Can we do these one by one, approve one by one?
Yes. No. We don't need a motion for each one. We're going to do it all at the end. Okay. The next selection is on page 274, and this is regarding the statement of items deferred for maintenance, repair, or replacement. Choice one is the board is not deferring the maintenance of its assets. All assets identified with a zero life will be addressed and proper action taken over the next year. Or choice two is in accordance with Civil Code Section 5300B4, and as of the date of this letter, the board has chosen to defer the replacement of some assets listed as follows. Currently, you are following choice one. As they come up due for replacement and repair, you are having it done. Clayton, you have a question?
Yeah, no, I'm just saying that the wording is kind of weird. If something may have reached its useful life but does not need to be repaired, I mean, this really doesn't say that. We don't repair it.
No, what you do is you extend the useful life, okay. And so the plan is adjusted.
It meets within the one choice thing.
Yes.
Just clear.
Okay, statement number five. The statement of anticipated special assessments in accordance with Civil Code Section 5300B5, and as of the date of this letter, the board A, does not anticipate, or B, anticipates, and it says include an estimated amount, that a special assessment will be required. At this time, it's my understanding, we do not anticipate any special assessments. Statement number six, statement of mechanisms to fund reserves. Currently, the board uses the following mechanism or mechanisms to fund reserves to repair or replace major components: A, choice one through regular assessments, or choice two says choose the following special assessments, borrowing, use of other assets, deferral of selected replacement or repairs. Currently, you are using regular assessments. Okay, you didn't need any selection on any. 7-8, statement addressing association outstanding loans. Currently, the association does not have any outstanding loans, so this would be choice one. And that was quick, right? Not so bad. Now we're on to our annual policy statement. We skip down to item three, posting location of general notices. Choice one states the location designated for posting of a general notice is, and every year we put in the bulletin board. That is our general notice location, is the bulletin board by the front desk. Choice two was we don't have a designated space spot. Okay, the next one is number 13 on page 277, asbestos notification. Choice one, the association is unaware of the presence of asbestos within any units or property within the association. Therefore, this section is not applicable. Or, if you're aware of it, we have to notify it. And at this point, we are unaware of any asbestos. In fact, I think we were outside of that time frame. Okay, item number 14, disclosure and accounting of reserves borrowed for litigation. Choice one is the association has not used reserve funds or temporarily transferred monies from the reserve fund to pay for any litigation. This is not applicable, so this entire section will be deleted. Okay, 15, AB 596, FHA and VA certification. Choice one, the common interest development is not a condominium townhome project. However, we do have a portion of our community that is FHA and VA certified, so we will be noting choice two, that the common interest development noted as the Springvale is a condominium townhome project. And it is certified by the Federal Housing Administration. And we will include the exhibit. And it is certified by the Federal Department of Veteran Affairs. Okay, optional disclosures. These are disclosures that you can include with our mailing or not. It talks about the disclosure of rental restrictions. Generally, we do put in a portion of the CCNRs that talks about rental restrictions. So that would be choice two. We do provide that. A disclosure of a senior community status. I think that applies. And then we would definitely include that as an exhibit to the disclosure policy. Members' right, we're on number 18. Members' right to opt out of sharing contact information. You have the option of including that option for the homeowners or not. In the past, we have been providing that option. This allows a homeowner to opt out from their information being distributed to any homeowner that asks for it. Number 19 is regarding gated communities, so this does apply to your community. And we do include choice two, where it says, while the association may have gated entries, staffed entrances, locked exterior doors, periodic patrols, neighborhood watch programs, TV cameras, and reporting equipment, these features cannot be relied upon to guarantee your personal safety and security. Some are merely deterrents, and others may help to identify a criminal after the fact, but even that is not certain. Thus, each owner is responsible for his or her own personal safety and security on the property. Owners must communicate these facts to their respective tenants and guests. This is a statement that is prepared by legal counsel. Smoke and carbon monoxide detectors. You can include this section or not include the section. In the past, we have included it, that owners are required by law to have operational smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors. Do you want to continue including that in your report? Guess that's it. Painless. So now I need a motion to approve the document.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the documents as we just went through and identified each individual.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to accept the annual budget report and annual policy statement. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Look at how quickly we cleared out this room. That's amazing. Okay, next on our agenda is the annual holiday home tour.
Okay, so real quickly, most of you guys know that over the years, ESC, Event Systems Committee, has sponsored a holiday home tour, which everybody loves. ESC, as you know, is no longer in existence, but Terry DiMarino and Jeff Davidson have continued to sponsor that. They're going to be on vacation, and when people started finding out that the holiday home tour was not going to be happening, they were bummed, mainly, especially, because everybody loves to go see Terry Fear's giant Disneyland home tour house, which he spends 3 months to put together. And many have a tradition now of having breakfast or lunch in the bistro and then going over to see the tour. Terry Fear's has generously offered to continue that for us this year, in spite of the fact that Davidson's on vacation. And his home, he's offering his home to be available to our residents. Kay Hoff was also included in that invitation, so if they would like to send sales prospects up there, they may. T- Terry is willing to take 100% of the responsibility and the liability of anything that might happen. Terry did reassure us too that he will be having some homeowner ambassadors on site as well, probably, and to help maintain order and be sure everything goes well. And Terry is also free of charge to the association, going to be providing refreshments, drinks and cookies. Wristbands are still going to remain at $5 a piece, and then all the proceeds, every bit of it, is going to go to our local Carol's Kitchen, which is who for the holidays, which is who Terry wanted to help contribute. He's got friends that work with them. So every penny that is donated will make somebody's Christmas better. That's it. Is that something the board wants to
do? So I'll make a motion to accept the proposal for the Terry Fears Holiday Home Tour.
Seconded. Moved and seconded to accept the proposal for the Tommy Fears Holiday Home Home Tour. All in favor?
Aye.
That's a great one. Okay, and secondly, right?
Yeah, I was just going to announce that the impact, if it wasn't approved, was that the homeowners at Four Seasons would be relegated to looking at good housekeeping magazines for holiday inspiration.
Yes, they would. Okay.
Cindy,
yes.
I have a question. Does Carol's Kitchen know about that?
I don't know if they know about that.
I'm on the board of directors.
Oh, great. Can you let them know? Well, see, we couldn't let them know until we knew if it was even going to happen, if it was going to be passed. Pass that. Good word on
them.
Yay! Okay, see, now it's even more important. Okay, so here's the next one. This is so precious. Background. Four Seasons residents, being a rather cultured lot, have thoroughly enjoyed in the past having an opportunity to experience the music and traditions of other countries. Our current situation. Four Seasons has been invited to welcome the musical talents of a traveling Inca group from Machu Picchu. Resident Susan Wilson has contacted the international director, and the group would be excited to fit us into their traveling schedule. What? Oh, okay. The date for the proposed musical presentation is Saturday. I'm getting there. I can't talk faster. I'm not a pink caller. Okay.
I did read it.
The date of the proposed musical presentation is Saturday, October 22nd from 4:30 to 5:30. 1 hour. In the lodge lobby. This will take advantage of the built-in bistro dinner guests and those wanting to come before karaoke that same night. These traveling musicians are not requesting any money to come and do their presentation. However, I would request those in the audience who are pleased with the performance
be able to donate. Can I make a motion, Cindy, that we go ahead and accept your proposal for the traditional Inca musical presentation?
That's great!
A second. All those in favor? The business to come before the board at this time. Meeting's adjourned.
Thank you.